Yes, so in this video I want to talk about adding a penalty against complexity. So we will be talking about the so-called norm penalties that we can add to the loss function. There are two common versions, the L1 and the L2 norm. And what they essentially do is you can think of it maybe in the context of a multi-layer perceptron. Let's say we have a hidden layer with three units and two output units. And then we have, let's say, two input features here. And yeah, as you know, everything is fully connected. Let me quickly draw that. So if we have a setup like this, and we have a large weight connection at this point, let's call it W1, compared to the other weights, let's say this is a very large weight, then here W1 will have a large effect on the network, although it's only one feature that has, let's say, a large weight. So if you have a lot of inputs, it might happen that there's one large weight and then it outweighs all the other features. So that could be causing a lot of noise or variance in the model. It could be very susceptible to small changes in the input that way. And by adding like a penalty against large weights, by keeping them more small and more uniform or closer together, we can help with preventing like fluctuations in the network. So yeah, you probably heard about L1 and L2 regularization from other statistics classes, so I will keep it relatively short here. It's also not the most important technique in deep learning. So it's also not, what I'm saying is, it's also not, let's say, a priority in this course to talk about it, because there are more, I would say, important techniques to talk about in the context of deep learning. But yeah, you may have heard of this in the context of lasso regression. So lasso regression is essentially a linear regression with an L1 penalty. And there's also ridge regression, which is essentially linear regression with an L2 penalty. And sometimes that's also called weight shrinkage, because it shrinks the weight, because a large weight will add a penalty against the loss, which will make more sense when I show you actually how it looks like. So here is an illustration of the L2 norm, or the L2 norm penalty. So L2 regularization, in a sense, for linear models, for example, for logistic regression, because in this course we talk more about classification rather than linear regression, but everything on this slide would also apply to linear regression. And then I will also later in this video show you that how we can generalize that to multilayer neural networks. It's actually pretty trivial. But just for simplicity, to take one step at a time, let's consider a logistic regression model here, where we have the loss function here. That's the negative log likelihood. And yeah, I'm just calling this cost here. So I took this, I think, from my book or something, where traditionally I differentiated between cost and loss. I called cost something that is computed over the whole training set, whereas the loss is, for instance, just on a single data point I here. But you can also think of it as loss if you like. So this is nothing new. This is how we compute the loss between the true label and the predicted label. And here, assume this is the binary cross entropy or negative log likelihood. Let's just say binary cross entropy. That is, again, nothing new. What's new is that we are adding now this term here, shown here, and this is essentially it's just a sum, the credit rate, so the weights squared, so that we don't have negative values. So we are just adding a sum over the squared weight terms here. So that means the larger the weights, because it's even squared, it's even having a larger effect, the larger the weights, the larger this regularized cost will become, right? So because if a weight has a large positive or a large negative value, this will make the regularized cost larger. And what is this term here? So this is lambda over n. This is just like a normalization term, and lambda is, I'm saying it here, it's a hyperparameter. It's something you have to choose. It's essentially the regularization strength. Right, so the larger lambda, the stronger the regularization. Usually people use a small number like 0.01 or 0.1 for regularization. But of course, you can also choose a number larger than one, and then that will be a pretty strong penalty. Yeah, and I'm not showing you really L1 regularization because it's the same concept, except that instead of using squared weights, you would use the absolute value here. Yeah, so this here is a geometric interpretation or a geometric intuition behind the L2 regularization. So this drawing is based on a seminar talk I once saw by Professor Robert Tipshirani. Hope I'm spelling this correctly, or his name. He was one of the main people working on these techniques, L1 and L2 regularization, if I remember correctly. And what this is showing is a surface plot of the loss function, let's say the mean squared error loss for linear regression. And we have a model, a linear regression model with two weights here, and let's ignore the bias unit for simplicity. And in the center here we have the loss minimum, so that's the point we want to reach. So we want to find the weights of the model such that the loss is minimized, the mean squared error is minimized. And the further we are apart here, these contours represent the magnitude of the MSE, so the further we are to the outside, the larger the loss. So really we want to find the weights here at this position, let's say, if we only focus on the ellipsoids here, these weight values that minimize the loss. That would be the regular MSE. That is something we can do via gradient descent, for example, as we've seen a couple of lectures ago. But now we have, yeah, we have this new term. We have the L2 norm, right, of the weights. So we have two weights, right? So over the two weights, we have this L2 norm, and it is added to the loss function. So the larger the weights, the higher the penalty here. And this gray circle here represents the penalty term, so this term here. Now, it becomes essentially a constrained optimization problem. We still want to find or reach zero loss, but the loss consists now of two parts. It consists of this MSE loss and this penalty term. So the penalty term is really here, use the pink color. Penalty term is really here, like this circle. And the MSE loss here, it's this one here. So we want to minimize both. We want to have small weights. So we want weights close to zero because of this term. But we also want to have the weights such that the MSE here is minimized. So in practice, what will happen is that, for instance, an optimization algorithm like gradient descent will find a good compromise between the two. So for instance, it will try to keep the weights close to zero, but also it will try to keep them close to this MSE loss. So for instance, it might find this compromise here between the two. So you can see here for this part, well, let me use green for this part, these weights are not too large, so they're somewhat close to this center that we want to minimize, but they are also somewhat close to this point, so it's like a compromise between the two. So that's how you can think of the L2 regularization. It's still minimizing the main loss under the constraint that we want to keep the weights relatively small. So in practice, what the practical implication of that is that, let's say you have a model, let's say a multilayer perceptron like that, it has a relatively complex decision boundary. It will essentially make the decision boundary somewhat simpler, for example, like that. If you have a very strong regularization, it might even become like a linear model, a too simple decision boundary. So yeah, usually you have to find a good hyperparameter for lambda to have a good regularization compromise here. So in the previous slides, I mentioned how that looks like for the generalized linear models like logistic regression, where we have just a sum over the weights. So how can we generalize that to multilayer neural networks where we have multiple layers of weights? We don't only have a weight vector, but also we have like weight matrices. Actually, it's very simple. We just use the Frobenius norm. So instead of having the sum over the elements in the vector, so instead of having the L2 norm, we now have the Frobenius norm, which is essentially the same as the L2 norm, except that we have a sum over the rows and the columns in the weight matrix. So we have here the Frobenius norm for one matrix in the layer L. Of course, we have multiple weight layers, so in that way you can either have a different lambda for each, so you can have a lambda for each layer, or you can use the same lambda for all the layers, but you also don't have to regularize all the layers, but that's usually common. So here, for instance, you would have a summation also over the Frobenius norms for the L layers. You can see that here, that's the Lth layer weight matrix, and each Frobenius norm would be computed via these two sums over the columns and the rows. So that's just a simple summation of the weights. Actually, the squared weights, of course. So now that we modified the loss function, so how do we do the training if we use gradient descent? It's actually pretty straightforward. So gradient descent, recall we take the derivative of the loss function with respect to the weights. And we would do the same thing now with the added penalty here. I mean, if you think about it, this is just plus, right? So it's a sum between the normal loss, let's call that the normal loss, and this regularization term. Because it's just a sum, we can use the sum rule and we can compute the derivatives separately. So this is the derivative as usual that we talked about, or gradient if you will. And then we can also compute this part separately and add them up. So for instance, if we have the gradient or partial derivative of the loss with respect to one of the weights here, we would have for the weight ij, the derivative of this regularization term as follows. Because it's just a square term, right? So if it's like this, we can just bring it up front, right? So in that way, very simple derivative, except we have, of course, we have this lambda term. And then also if we have a summation over n in our loss, we also have a normalization here over n. So this is essentially it, how we compute that. So over n here is over the training examples, right? Okay, so anything? Oh yeah, so we have also here an example of how we implement this in PyTorch. So I have actually a code example. I will just upload this and link this on Canvas, but it's so simple that I don't even need to show you this in a separate notebook, I think. So how we can regularize the loss is by just summing over the weights in the model. So if you initialize your model, you can then iterate over these model parameters, and notice we only regularize the weights, not the bias units. So here I'm iterating over all the parameters in the model. I'm using named parameters instead of just parameters. Notice this is model.parameters is something you would give into the or provide to the optimizer, so you have seen that before. Now we are using named parameters. Why are we doing that? So that we can then say here only choose the weights, not the biases. And then we add these to the loss. So let's say we have the L2 term here, we accumulate all of these, just the squared sums of these weights. So P is a weight. And then we add this to the loss here. So I'm calling it cost, but you can also call it loss. So this one is essentially what we have seen in the previous slide. Lambda is our regularization strength here. So this is essentially what I was showing you here, except for all the weights, of course. And this is something you would do during the training loop, during the for loop. So that would be one way you can do L2 regularization for neural networks in PyTorch. But there's even a simpler way. So what you can do is, instead of what I've shown you in the previous slide, you can just choose this weight decay argument here, or you can use this weight decay argument in the of the SGD optimizer, and you can just provide the lambda regularization strength to the weight decay here, and it will do L2 regularization for you. So actually, you don't even have to bother with this. I mean, this is optionally if you like to do it manually, but you can also just do it automatically by specifying this here in the optimizer. And this is it. So that's all you need to do for L2 regularization in neural network training. Okay, so this was L2 regularization in a nutshell. I would say I recommend maybe trying this out in practice, but I must say it's not super common anymore. What's more common is using Dropout, which we will be discussing in the remaining parts of this lecture. Actually, I originally planned to only make one video, but then I think it might be a super long video, so I'm splitting it into four shorter parts. So let's get started then and finish up this lecture on regularization by talking about Dropout.